I've talked in the past about the differences between different editions of Windows, between Home and Pro, but I thought in this video I would go over really the three main big features in Pro Edition that I think make it worth it over Home, and go a little bit more detail into them. So this is not gonna be just a Windows Home versus Pro comparison differences video. I'm really gonna focus on these three things that I think make it the most useful for like a power user as opposed to a business user. The first feature is one that I have talked about before, Windows Sandbox, and basically it just lets you boot up a temporary instance of Windows completely clean, nothing in it, as if you had just done a fresh install, and actually a lot less than a fresh install. And it's very simple. Anything you do in there is temporary, and when you close the virtual machine, the sandbox, everything in there is forgotten, wiped out, and when you relaunch it, it's completely clean again. And this can be useful for several reasons. First, since it is contained and kind of protected, it is useful for running software that you might not fully trust. Like, you don't think it's a virus or anything, but you're not totally sure. You can run it in the sandbox and be pretty confident about it. But it's also good for testing out software that you don't really want to install and then realize, oh, this didn't do what I actually wanted, and then immediately have to uninstall it and clutter up your system or leave any leftover files. So it's good for testing out software before you install it on your main computer. Or it might be software that you only need to use once. You know you're not going to need to use it again, and it requires you to install it, just install it in the sandbox and do it. And you can actually configure the sandbox in a few ways. So you can create these WSB or Windows Sandbox configuration files and then launch it, and it will have whatever settings you put in there. So for example, you can have settings for whether the sandbox will be allowed network access or whether it will be allowed to share the clipboard and how much memory, things like that. And importantly, you can also have it run a logon command. So once the virtual machine boots up, you can basically have it do whatever you want. So I have several of these configuration files. For example, I have one configuration that when it logs on, it changes the DNS to use Google DNS instead of the one I usually use on my network, which has a bunch of filtering and stuff. So if I'm having weird network issues, I can use the sandbox that kind of bypasses all that and see if it's something I'm filtering or just the website itself. I also have a primary configuration that I use, which does stuff like mapping a certain folder on my host to show up on the desktop of the sandbox, and it's read-only, so nothing can mess with it. And then that folder has some scripts and tools in there that I might use regularly. The main one being a PowerShell script that I have run at the startup of the sandbox as well, and that does a whole bunch of stuff like restoring the old context menu, it enables showing file extensions and also hidden files, and it also adds some context menu options like to edit with Notepad when I right-click a file, since apparently the Windows Sandbox currently doesn't have Notepad. I think they really stripped it down for security purposes or something. Anyway, so I put a copy of Notepad in the shared folder so it can just launch that directly. And I also have additional scripts in that shared folder, like one that sets dark mode and also changes to a darker wallpaper so I don't blind myself at night. And then there's another script if I need it to install WinGet, and that makes it easy to test and install certain software on there. Although I think at the moment, this one's broken by a recent update, but you get the idea. So yeah, Windows Sandbox, definitely one of my favorites. I use it all the time, probably easily worth the price of entry for Pro Edition alone. But again, that is only the first of the three features that I think make it worth it. Before I get to those though, something else that's worth it is today's sponsor, Delete Me, a data privacy service to which I myself have been a paying customer for over 4 years now, from before they ever even sponsored. If you've ever Googled yourself, you definitely have seen all the countless data broker websites who not only collect and display all your personal information, like name, address, and phone number, but then also go and sell it to companies and other sketchy people to do whatever they want with it. This also makes it easier for malicious people to find and use your own info against you in phishing attacks, identity theft, harassment, and more. But that's where Delete Me comes in. They do all the work for you in submitting removal requests on your behalf. At the moment, they automatically scan 133 data brokers and are constantly adding new ones that pop up. And when you sign up, you get a privacy report showing exactly which sites you were removed from after 7 days and every 3 months after that. You can even submit custom requests to remove your data from hundreds of other sites, where an expert will handle it for you. This even includes from some surprising sites like berkeley.edu and certain government sites, so not just purely data brokers. Plus, Delete Me has other useful privacy tools like email masking and phone number masking for US users. So if you want to get your personal information removed from the web and search results, go to joindeleteme.com/TheoJo and use the promo code TheoJo for 20% off all US consumer plans. And with all that being said, let's continue. All right, so next up, I think the second major feature that makes Windows Pro Edition worth it is Hyper-V virtual machines. So the Windows Sandbox is good for like a one-time temporary thing. You can't save the state of it in there. Once you stop it, it's all gone. Whereas with Hyper-V, you can create a whole bunch of virtual machines, and I have, and they are persistent. You shut it down, you boot it back up, it's still how it was. And you manage it through this Hyper-V manager that is part of the Windows Pro Edition. And you can see that I have a whole bunch of virtual machines with various versions of Windows, which is good for testing. If I'm making a video comparing different editions of Windows, that can really come in handy. Or if I want to go see what something looked like in an old version, stuff like that. But I also have other ones that are Windows 11, the latest version, for testing other stuff. For example, I have one virtual machine that I use mostly for programming. So I have the Visual Studio and all the stuff that's downloaded through that all in one place, especially since sometimes when you're doing programming, you want to download packages from NuGet or whatever, third-party packages. And one time when I was doing that on my main machine a couple years ago, I almost accidentally downloaded and ran a malicious package, and that sketched me out. So I want to contain all that. Anytime I'm going to be potentially downloading from sources that I can't like inspect individually, I want to have that all isolated. And similarly, I have one for AI image generation, like with Stable Diffusion, and a lot of those image generator tools use Python, and you can get a bunch of plugins and stuff to add on with it, but they all use Python too. And a lot of times these packages that people come up with, they have like a million dependencies that in themselves have dependencies, and you don't really understand what all the stuff is installing behind the scenes. So I want to keep all that isolated as well. And actually, I read about on Reddit, one time there was someone made a plugin for a Stable Diffusion, and I think it was like somewhat popular, and it ended up having malware in it, like purposefully. So I'm gonna keep anything where I'm gonna be downloading from package managers and stuff definitely isolated. And what's nice about virtual machines is you can have them with snapshots. So if you're gonna be maybe installing a program that you're not sure you're gonna keep or something messes up, you can create a snapshot of what the virtual machine is like before that, and then if something gets messed up, you can simply restore it. And it's more than just doing a system restore like you might on your computer. Rather, it does a complete full restore of exactly what the machine was like. So that can definitely come handy too. All right, so moving on to the third big reason, and that is the group policy editor. And actually, I'm gonna lump in a bunch of other exclusive management consoles, they're called. Group policy editor is one of them. And it's gpedit.msc if you've ever run it. And basically it just allows easy access to a whole bunch of behind the scenes settings in Windows. It's meant mostly for companies that want to deploy like the same configuration of a computer across their whole company. You can basically create a single policy with every conceivable configuration and then just have Windows automatically set it up like that. So a lot of these are business oriented settings. However, there is some stuff in there that as a user, you might find useful. Now, I will point out that a lot of these settings actually can be configured without having to use the group policy editor, because a lot of the time they're just registry settings. And actually Microsoft does publish a spreadsheet with all the latest policies that you can look at, what they're called, and then exactly which registry entry it changes. So you'd probably have to look up the actual value for which configuration, but if you did hear about a group policy that you wanted to set, you could just do it through the registry yourself. It's just a lot easier with the GUI. However, there is some stuff beyond simply changing settings. There is some stuff that actually is exclusive to the group policy editor. One of them is App Locker. I made a whole video about this. I'm not really gonna get into it, but basically, for super advanced users, it basically lets you whitelist programs instead of having a retroactive policy of antivirus where if something runs, it checks if it's bad. With App Locker, you can kind of define what things are even able to run in the first place. I'm not going to get into it. Most people don't want to enable it, but I use it. Another useful thing is startup and shutdown scripts for both the whole system and the user. Now, you can have startup scripts run through Task Scheduler. You can do that already with Home Edition. And you can also, of course, maybe put a batch file in the startup folder. But this actually can make it a lot easier, especially for PowerShell scripts. And also with Task Scheduler, I believe it's harder to do shutdown scripts. It's not always reliable, apparently. So if you're someone who has a whole bunch of scripts they want to set up to run at when the computer starts or when a specific user starts, this might be an easier way to manage it than creating scheduled tasks. There's also this policy-based quality of service settings, which I've never really used, but apparently it can be used to prioritize network traffic. So I read on Reddit, someone talked about a while ago how on their internet connection when they're gaming, if there's other stuff downloading in the background, it messes up their ping. So they have kind of a tutorial where you can use this to basically trick Windows into thinking that it's telephone traffic, which has the highest priority, by setting a certain value with this thing. If you wanted to prioritize traffic, it wouldn't like download things faster necessarily. It probably would just make a difference if you're downloading multiple things and you wanted to make sure that one had the lowest latency. However, the Group Policy Editor is not the only management console. There is a couple others that are exclusive to Windows Pro. One of them is luser-manager.msc. This is for local users and groups. This makes it easy to see not just your actual user accounts, but also built-in system accounts and accounts that are disabled or hidden. So you can see here, mine doesn't have the down arrow. It's the only one that's not disabled. And there's these other built-in ones. You can also see user groups. I've never had to touch this. I think this is more if you're in a domain and you're managing permissions across different types of users, that sort of thing. But you can also see other info if you go to the properties of a user. You can see stuff like which groups they're a member of. You can set a login script for this particular user as well, and I guess override certain paths. I've never had to use this, but you can get a bit more info. There's also the Security Policy Management Console. This one actually is just built into the Group Policy Editor, so it's not really a separate thing. Then there's also this Resultant Set of Policy Management Snap-in, which is basically looks the same as the Group Policy Editor, except it pretty much only shows settings that you've changed. So you can also just use this command, which is a GP result. I think this actually will work on Home Edition. You just can't change anything. And it'll show you exactly which policies you changed. That way you can import it again later. And then there's this print management snap-in, which I found helpful recently. It basically shows all the info about installed printers and drivers all in one place. And this can come in handy. For example, recently I reinstalled a driver for my printer, and I had an issue where it then started showing up twice in some places, like Microsoft Word and when I went to print a document, but one of them didn't work. Only one of them worked, and when I went into the usual Windows 11 settings, it only showed one, so I couldn't remove the offline messed up one. And it also wasn't even showing up in the device manager, and even in the window for showing more devices, it wouldn't show up here. But fortunately, when I opened up the print management console, you can see it does show both of them. And one of them even says offline, and apparently there's some job that's stuck trying to be deleted on there that's just not going anywhere. So yeah, this allows me to actually remove that properly, whereas before I couldn't do it. Now, I will say I also discovered that you can access one of the old control panel pages if you create a special CLSID link, it's called, to this one. And it does show up in there, so I guess that's sort of a workaround. But again, that's kind of a hassle, and you'd have to just know about that. But at least if you come across a similar issue, you can check with that. It might show up there too. So I would be very curious to know if you guys maybe didn't know about these features or just how useful they really were, and maybe now you'll consider getting it. Or maybe there's a feature that I didn't talk about that you think is one of the big reasons why it's worth it. Or of course, it's very possible you don't need any of this and you don't think it's worth it at all for you personally. That's totally fine. So give the video a thumbs up if you thought this video was cool, and we could talk about all that down in the comments. Let me know. Thanks again to DeleteMe for sponsoring. And again, if you want to have your personal info removed from data brokers, go to joindeleteme.com/TheoJo and use the promo code TheoJo for a discount. Now, if you want to keep watching, next I would recommend where I again compared Home and Pro editions, but talked about more of the differences, just didn't go quite as in depth into each one. So if you're wondering about more of the little differences, I cover a lot more detail in there. So I'll put that link right there you can click on. So thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.